One of the age-old debates when it comes to import drag racing is the 2JZ versus the RB26 or RB30 these days. And we've got fans on both sides that are pretty heated about supporting their particular brand of choice. Now, Billet Race Engineering have been making billet aluminium blocks for both the 2JZ and the RB26 for some time now. And we're here with Darren from Billet Race Engineering to talk about a unique twist that they've just applied to their RB30 block. So, let's get into the elephant in the room here, the 2JZ and the RB26. And in a subtle way, you've actually kind of combined two aspects into one block. So can you tell us what you've done here?
Well, we've had a look at the two engines, and basically what we've seen is the 2J, the crankshaft in the 2J, we have a 7mm larger main journal. So when you have a look at this in the design of the crankshaft, in the RB crankshaft with the small main journal, we're getting a lot of torsional twist in the over the length of the crankshaft, which of course takes power away from the back wheels because it's going into bending the crankshaft. And so what we thought was, how about if we make an RB crankshaft with a bigger main bearing? And as it happens, the 2J main bearing shells would easily fit into an RB configuration. So it was a matter of changing the tunnel size and moving the main studs to the appropriate location and increasing the material down there, and then designing a crank to suit.
All right, so let's back up, and I can feel the heat building on the internet already. So let's be real clear, this is not a 2JZ. This is still very much an RB. You're still using an RB head. Essentially, it's still an RB30 in terms of the block architecture, and really the part that you've borrowed, stolen from the 2JZ is just that main bearing journal diameter, giving you easy access to an off-the-shelf bearing that your customers can then buy and install.
Yeah, correct. So it was just, you know, you didn't want to go in and take it to the extreme where you design a custom bearing, which then costs a fortune and then just adds to the price of the overall project.
All right, so you've got that 7mm bigger journal diameter, and am I right in guessing that that's going to increase the overlap between your main bearing journal on the crankshaft and your big end journal, adding to the rigidity of the crankshaft? That's what you're talking about with reducing the torsional twist?
It does, it reduces it in that way, but in another way we've reduced the overlap. We still have more than what we would with a 90mm stroke RB crank, but we've gone and used a Honda big end journal. And the reason that we've done that is that's what's being used in the industry at the moment. But in addition to that, because it's smaller, that allows us to have more material in the aluminium rod around the rod bolt, which is the weakness. Some people question the rod bolt, but if you knew where, like, how the aluminium was behaving around the rod bolt, that's where you'd be worried. So that's given us a lot more material around there.
Okay, so it's important to mention there as well that that Honda big end bearing, that's actually become quite a common choice. A lot of the V8 guys are also running that shell, so it's not an uncommon decision to go that way.
No, and I mean, even in the world record engines now in the 2J format, that's the big end bearing that they're using as well. So why not stick with it? It's not broken, so why fix it?
Now, you've mentioned there that one of the drivers with going to that smaller big end bearing journal diameter is the spacing there with the rod bolts. And a lot of this comes down to the clearance that you've got with the aluminium rod. It's a very bulky rod compared to a steel rod. And you've got clearance considerations there when you're still running what is, in V8 terms, a relatively small bore diameter. Is that accurate?
Yeah, so because you have a small bore diameter, like you're well under a 4-inch bore, you have to get the conrod down the bore to assemble the engine, so that limits how wide the conrod can be. So by reducing the size of the big end pin, that gives us more material because we're limited on the outside diameter.
Now, one of the issues, obviously, going to a custom block like this where you've manipulated the main bearing journal size, the big end journal sizes, obviously you're no longer going to be able to run an off-the-shelf crankshaft. So how have you dealt with that?
So in conjunction with Callies, we designed a crankshaft for this new platform and sent a design with them with some back and forth with their engineers. And then we've come up with a new crankshafts, which is what they call in their ultra billet range, which is their name for that product. So it's the same as their Pro Mod cranks or in their V8 range or whatever they'd make. And it's entirely made in the United States and shipped out here. We've had 15 of them made. So we have an engine that will be run for the first time in a couple of weeks in the US. And the whole idea behind this was to get Nissan up there with the 2J. There's a lot of Nissan guys that are running 2Js because that's a platform that's evolved. And now we have a level playing field. And now it's Nissan versus Toyota in the Pro Outlaw classes. And let's let the guys battle it out and see who can be the fastest.
Now, fair enough. Now, before I talk a little bit more about the power levels you're expecting, with that crankshaft, again, obviously going to a custom billet crankshaft, huge amount of flexibility on other design parameters. So is there anything else you've changed in that crankshaft to give an advantage with this new motor?
Yeah, so one of the other failings with the RB crankshaft was the snout. So the snout is quite small in diameter, and it's not as long as what you would like, meaning that the balancer only really has about 19 millimeters of purchase on the front. So what we did there was we've increased the diameter by 5 millimeters, which gives us more wall thickness between the balancer bolt bore and the outside diameter. And then we've increased the keyway to a 5/16 keyway. And we've increased the length by another 19 millimeters. So we've basically doubled the amount of purchase that the balancer has on the end of the crankshaft. And so you can still use the ATI balancer, but we have a hub. So you still use the outer ring, but then you use a custom hub.
And also, you mentioned off camera before, you've made some changes to the flywheel drive flange as well.
Yeah, so we've gone to an 8-bolt. We've increased the flywheel flange by 10 millimeters in size, and then we've gone from 6 bolts to 8 bolts. And we've changed the pitch circle as well. We didn't run with a 2J pitch circle with the 8 bolts because the pitch circle put the bolts out fairly close to the outside and made the wall thickness a little bit thin. So we came in a little bit there, and we used a 716 UNF thread, which means that you can use a small block Chevy or small block, big block Chevy flywheel bolt. Which is just for ease, and you know, there's plenty of that stuff around, and it's cheap. So
like a lot of little subtle modifications there aimed at increasing the material thickness, the wall thickness, and obviously changing there to those readily available bolts, as you've just mentioned, for the flywheel. So all these subtle things add up to increase reliability at these sort of point. These engines now are producing 2,500-3,000 wheel horsepower and potentially above that, which is a nice segue. Where do you sort of see the limitations of this block when it's pushed to its maximum?
Well, it's hard to say. The guys at the moment, when you have a look at the numbers that they're running, they must be up at around the 3,200 horsepower level. Talking with some of the teams, they're at 100 PSI of boost, and they're adding some nitrous for good measure. So what's really becoming the limitation now is the cylinder head. So they effectively, if you have a look at the cylinder heads, the factory cylinder heads, the amount of CFM that they flow is below what's required for that size engine at the RPM they're turning. So once the cylinder head development comes along, which, you know, we're working on billet cylinder heads now. So once that comes along and we've sized the cylinder head and the port size is correct for the engine size and RPM, then I think we'll see even higher power levels.
It's been interesting to get some insight into the engine and the reason you've made those changes. And we'll certainly look forward to seeing if the RB guys can actually take it to the 2J guys and compete on an even footing with this engine. So thanks for a chat there, Darren.
No worries. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.